Good morning to all of you. Today, actually, I will start with a very important topic, which is Gaussian random processes. But before I go to Gaussian random processes, let me briefly, once again, repeat the basic parameters on which the statistical analysis is done. Right? So in this chapter, for this evaluation also, you will see that these metrics that I will discuss play a very important role in every question you will find. All right. So you should be very thoroughly clear about and just practice some questions based on this. I have already uploaded the required PPTs in detail. So you can refer to those PPTs. I don't suppose that you need to go at present for the evaluation. Otherwise, you must develop a habit of studying books. Populus is the book. And one more book I have given from Cambridge University. But at least for the evaluation or the exam point of view, you should go through at least the notes, which I have already uploaded on LMS. Right. So I wanted to discuss actually very briefly so that you can make out what is the difference and what I'm trying to say. First of all, I have already explained in detail what is a random process. Random process is, a collection of time functions. At one particular time, say T1, T2, T2, we get random variables. So that means the random process is a collection of random variables, very roughly speaking. So I would like to go through quickly the metrics. The metrics start from mean. So mean of a random process, XT, is defined by, so this is the formula, mean, this is the expected value of XT, means this is the expected value of this random process XT, and this is given by integral from minus infinity to plus infinity X. That means the values that this process will take, right, X into or the values of the random variable particularly at particular times. Because at every time, XT is a random process. So when I try to evaluate the random process at a particular time, let's say T1, so that becomes a random variable and it will have certain values. So the values into the probability density function, F subscript XT of X dx, this is the probability density function into X, right, PDF of XT. So that's how you can get mean. Mean is basically a function of time. All right. Now let's come back. I will very quickly, I will not go into the details of these parameters, but quickly I will I will tell you the formulas and the importance. The autocorrelation function, Rx, it is denoted by R subscript X, and it is dependent on two times, T1 and T2 of a random process XT. At two different times, right? Autocorrelation, what is the correlation between the same process at different times? Basically, that's the meaning. Autocorrelation of a random process is defined as, so this is calculated as expected value of XT1 into XT2, and this will be a double integral XY. Y means this is the second value for at time T2. Or you can put it here, x square also, fx t1, fx t2, xy, dx, dy. All right. So in general, the autocorrelation function is a function, autocorrelation is a function of t1 and t2, the independent two times at which we are trying to do the measurements. But when, if you remember, when the autocorrelation, actually the autocorrelation function is dependent on time t1 and t2. But the for a wide sense, so this will be a strictly stationary process. So for a wide sense stationary process, the autocorrelation function will be dependent on the difference between the two times rather than the absolute value of the two times. So if you remember previously. Now there is one more parameter which is known as the autocovariance. This is denoted by C subscript X T1 T2 of a random process is defined as the covariance of XT1 and XT2. So XT1 and T2. Now the covariance is defined as the expected value of XT1 minus the mean, XT2 minus the mean at time T2. So this can be proven to be equal to autocorrelation function. Autocovariance function is given by the autocorrelation function minus the the product of the two means at two different times. We know the definition of the variance also, right? XT minus mean square is the variance. And there is one more important parameter, which is the correlation coefficient. And this is given by rho XT1 T2. It is C XT1 T2 divided by the under root of the two. And rho will always be less than, the modulus of rho will always be less than or equal to one. That means that the value of the correlation coefficient will vary from minus one to one. Okay. I have included these examples in tube sheet number 9, which will actually be available to you in the next week. So, but I can do one example here. XT is equal to, let's say this is the random process. XT equal to A cos 2 pi t, where A is a random variable. So A is a random variable. Now we want to find out the mean. So mean, we know that the expected value of A cos 2 pi t, we can apply that formula here, this formula, and we can find out the expected value. All right, since in this case, only A is the random variable, so there is no random variable, there is not other any random variable. So that means the expected value of, we have to talk about the expected value of A cos 2 pi. So that's the mean. In the same way, we can find out the autocorrelation and the autocovariance. Right, so these are the few definitions which I actually wanted to discuss before I start the Gaussian random process. I will stop sharing this PPT because this PPT is already made PPT and this is available on your LMS. So you can go through that. But I would like to share with the Gaussian random process now. Just give me one. Okay. So let me share the Gaussian random process. So a little important topic for your exam point of view also and for the understanding point of view also, because the noise present in the electronic circuits, computer circuits, we generally model it as Gaussian noise, right? So we must understand the what is Gaussian process actually. So, okay. So what is a Gaussian random process? Let's try to understand this concept. So let us say that Xi's are the random variables. We can say that these random variables, because there are many random variables, the random variables are varying from x1 to xn. I is an index here. So these random variables are jointly Gaussian. I have already talked about what is a Gaussian distribution. So we can say that Xi's are jointly Gaussian random. This is a property from where we will start. Xi's are, these are random variables, but we can say that these are jointly Gaussian random variables if the linear combination of these random variables, any linear combination depending on the value of Gi. So I is varying from 1 to n. There can be many possibilities of having this linear combination. But we choose a linear combination so that any linear combination of these random variables happens to be a Gaussian random variable. So these random variables are said to be jointly Gaussian if the linear combination of these random variables happens to be a Gaussian random variable. That means y comes out to be a Gaussian random variable for all combinations ranging from I from 1 to n. And then Xi's are jointly Gaussian. So we will use this property of defining jointly Gaussian random variables that any linear combination of these random variables will result into a Gaussian random variable. So we will use this property to define Gaussian random process. A random process Xt is a Gaussian random process if the random variables, because Xt is a process taking the process at time t1, t2, t3 will give us the random variables. A random process xt is a Gaussian random process. If the random variables xt1, t2 up to xtn are jointly Gaussian, and we have already defined what is a jointly Gaussian random variable, are jointly Gaussian for all choices of t1, t2, tn and for all n. So xt is a Gaussian random process. If these random variables are joint Gaussian random variables jointly, and we can put it like this, this is a discrete form of the joint Gaussian random variables, and this is a continuous form of the joint random variable resulting into a Gaussian random variable. So gt's are the weighted coefficients and xt is the Gaussian random process. If right, so that's the basic condition, that's the criteria of defining a Gaussian random process. And there is one more condition we need to put, that for what should be the choice of, you know, there cannot be any arbitrary choice of gt, but at least gt, the weighted coefficient from where we are doing the linear combination, it should be, the integral of gt square should be equal, should be less than equal to infinity. That means it should be a finite finite coefficient, weighted coefficient, right? Now there are some properties of the Gaussian process. First property I will describe, but I will not prove it, because this is something related to the linear filters, which probably at the second or third semester you probably will not be able to understand, because no filtering is done. This will come into your DSP course. But so I will leave this property as a proof to be solved by you in probably in the fifth semester. But let me tell the property. If xt, which is a random process, maybe a noise signal, you know, noise is a random process. And if xt is passed through a stable linear filter, then the output process is also Gaussian. That means if we are modeling the noise in an electronic circuit as Gaussian, then if the noise is passing through electronics, you know, it can be filters, it can be other analysis algorithms. So if the noise is Gaussian and it is passing through the electronic components, so the resultant noise will also be Gaussian. So that way we can, you know, mathematically develop the models for designing electronic systems. Now, the question is that how do you characterize PDF of XT? We know that there are random variables. We must be able to derive the formula for the probability density function of these joint probability density function of these random variables. So I'm taking m jointly Gaussian random variables, x1, x2 up to xn. These are Gaussian random variables. And I'm making an assumption here, which I will remove in the next slides. I'm making the assumption that these are independent and these are IIDs. IIDs means identical and independent and identically distributed random variables. Right, independent and identically distributed. I will explain this term. Let's say mu x1 is the mean of this random variable, mu x2 is the mean of x2, and so on. I define the variances also for these random variables. Now, what I need to find out? I need to find out the joint probability density function of these random variables. So every random variable is a Gaussian random variable, but I have to find out the joint probability density function. So once every random variable is a Gaussian random variable, I can use a standard formula of Gaussian distribution, which is 1 over under root of pi sigma e to the power minus x minus mu squared divided by 2 sigma squared. So if I use that formula, and there are, you know, how many random variables, capital N random variables. So the probability density function of these random variables, so I can have a multiplication of the individual distributions, Gaussian distribution. So that means there will be a multiplication. There will be n times multiplication. I will vary from 1 to n. of the basic distribution formula. So 1 over under root 2 pi, I will use here a parameter which is sigma xi, which will actually take values of these i's because there are n random variables. Each random variable is a Gaussian distribution. Minus xi minus mu xi whole square divided by 2 sigma xi square. So I is the index which is giving me the joint probability density function. I am writing this formula taking every random variable as a Gaussian random variable. So I'm using the Gaussian distribution here. Now I will be doing a little bit of mathematics, not very complex mathematics, but so if there is a product, that means 2 pi times n, it will be 2 pi times n by 2, 2 pi times power n by 2, because it is 2 pi raised to the power 1 by 2 multiplied by n. So it will be 2 pi raised to the power n by 2. And how many sigma x1, x2, x2 up to sigma n. So these will also be multiplied. Sigma 1, sigma, I'm dropping this xi from here just for the sake of simplicity. Sigma 1, 2 up to sigma n. And how I am modifying this exponent, these exponents I am taking, you see, e to the power x into e to the power y into e to the power z. I can also write as e to the power x plus y plus z. So instead of the multiplication, I am using sigma here, right? So this will be xi minus mu I square divided by sigma square. So e to the power sigma, rather than the product I'm using here, e to the power sigma, I varying from 1 to n, xi minus mu I square divided by sigma I square, and I'm taking 1 by 2 out from here in the exponent, minus 1 by 2. So I'm taking minus 1 by 2 out, and this factor is in the exponent only, minus 1 by 2 taken out, rather I'm using the summation term here. Right. Then this is the joint PDF of these random Gaussian random variables in the case when these are IIDs, independent and identically distributed random variable. I want to make a generalized probability density function. So for that, I will have to put this joint probability density function formula in a more, I have to a little bit manipulate this formula. So let me do that. In that case, I will define a term which is covariance between ith and the jth random variable. And we know that what I have just discussed, what is the definition of the covariance? Covariance is given by expected value of xi minus mu xi and xj minus mu xj. And this is central moment, right? For I not equal to j, this is going to be zero. When the elements are independent and identically distributed, this is only for that. This covariance terms, when I is not equal to j, this will be zero only when the element, the random variables are in question, random variables in question are IIDs, independent and identically distributed. The expected value will be zero because there is no correlation between the different random variables, the probability distribution of two different random variables. So this is going to be zero. But when I is equal to j, this will turn out to be the variance, right? When I is equal to j, x minus mu square, this will turn out. So I will be in the matrix, in this matrix actually. I am writing it in the form of a matrix. You know, this can be written in the form of matrix also, right? And I will explain this point. I have one example also that will actually make the things very clear. When I is equal to j, so you will, all other elements will be zero for this covariance matrix. But what are the, so the matrix will result into, I can express the covariance values between different random variables. Covariance is defined like this: for I not equal to j, all values will be zero when they are IIDs, right? So only values left will be the diagonal values. So these are actually the variances, sigma x1 square up to sigma xn square. All other elements will be zero. So what is this matrix? This matrix whose ith and jth element is the covariance of this covariance matrix. All other elements are zero, only the diagonal elements are having values, which are basically the variances. So this matrix is known as the covariance matrix associated with random variables x1, x2, and xn. Right. So, but I actually want to drop this condition of IIDs. I want to make a more general. In the case of IIDs, you will get zeros, but I want to drop this condition. Now consider the collection of these random variables. So we have how many random variables? We have n random variables, x1 to xn. So I will now do some manipulation in the same equation using kind of vector analysis. So I define a vector, column vector basically, of these random variables, x1 up to x, x1, x2 up to xn. And covariance matrix, what is covariance matrix? Covariance matrix returns the covariance of every pair of elements of the co. So these covariance matrix will determine the covariance of every element with every other element. For statistically independent random variables, the covariance matrix will be diagonal that I have just discussed. But I want to drop this condition so that every other element should be non-zero. It should not have a zero value. Right? So how can I do that? I am rewriting the same equation. How I am rewriting the equation? Which equation? So I have this joint probability density function, 2 pi raised to the power n by I have just explained you. So this is the equation which I am trying to rewrite. So what is my vector of random variables? X vector, this is x definite. This is the symbol of x vector. And this is my column vector that I'm defining. And I am also defining a row vector. Since x bar is a column vector, so x bar transpose is a row vector. And this is my matrix, sigma, sigma bar. Sigma bar is my covariance matrix. So I will, what is this equation? If you look at this equation, right? This equation is actually of the form x1, this is the column vector, multiplied by the matrix, multiplied by the row, this is the row vector actually. Once you take x bar is a column vector, when you take the transpose, it will become a row vector. The first is a row vector, this is a matrix. Just explained for the IIDs, when the random variables are IIDs, and this is the third part, which is the column vector, right? And this is a quadratic form of matrix A. This is actually defined like this, sigma Aij, Xij, Xj. But we will not take X1 up to Xn, rather we will define this vector, X bar minus mu bar. So X bar minus mu bar, because we have here X bar minus mu bar, X bar minus mu bar is a vector, column vector. Rather than putting here X1 up to Xn values, I will be putting X1 minus mu bar and so on. So I will define this vector X bar minus mu bar, right? So this will be, what is the joint probability density function in that case? It will be, so I am defining this, excuse me, the exponent part as minus 1 by 2 x minus mu bar. So this factor is basically, this is of this form, x transpose, this matrix, the vector multiplied by matrix multiplied by vector. So this is of this form. So I can write it like this, minus 1, you can check it, there's no issue. Minus, and we will take an example also. Minus 1 by 2, x minus mu, this is the matrix, it's inverse basically, and this is the other vector. Instead of x, I'm writing x minus mu bar, because here my vector is x minus mu, right? So I can change this expression using in this form, using this basic quadratic form of matrix, right? And now What is this? If you go to the previous slide, what is this value? If you look at the denominator part, sigma 1 into sigma 2 into sigma n, this is what? This is the determinant of this matrix. This is the under root of the determinant of this matrix, right? So I can replace it like this. My formula becomes, the joint probability density function becomes 1 over 2 pi raised to the power n by 2, determinant of this matrix, 1 by raised to the power 1 by 2, exponent of minus 1 by 2, x minus mu. This is the vector that I transpose. This is my covariance matrix inverse, and this is my row vector. Generalized form. So what is this formula? How it is different from the previous formula? This formula eliminates the condition, the assumption for independent and identically distributed random variables. So now in this, with this equation, the matrix, the other elements of the matrix will not have zero values, right? So there will be covariance in play rather than the variance. So why to go for matrix notation? Now I can define joint. Now I can actually matrix the idea of putting everything into the matrix notation was to eliminate this condition of independent and independent random variables. So therefore, now I have defined the probability, joint probability density function of the Gaussian random process when the random variables are not independent random variables. So it's a more general form of the joint probability distribution function. So covariance matrix, what is the importance of covariance matrix? Excuse me. Covariance matrix will actually capture the information about the statistical dependence of random variables, that how the random variables are dependent on each other. So covariance matrix will actually take that information. So when this matrix, covariance matrix, become diagonal matrix, this is a special case for statistical independence, right? And we can use another notation, because I'm using here this kind of notation, that p subscript x1 x2 up to xn of x1 x2. I can use a vector here. So this is just a notation, p of x bar as an argument, which is basically the joint density function of its components. All right, so this is the formula that we have derived. Now let me take an example, actually. So rest of the things can be, you can read it from the presentation that I've already shared. I will share it just now. Now let us look at an example, which will actually do the correlation, which will actually correlate the formula that I've just described and how it is to be, understood. We have a Gaussian random process, which is WSS. WSS means Weissmann stationary. What is a Weissmann stationary process? If you remember, if a process is to be proven to be Weissmann stationary, then mean has to be constant, number one. Number two, the autocorrelation function, Rx T1, T2, should be equal to Rx T1 minus T2. The autocorrelation function should be dependent on the difference between the time. We have to prove that, but not on the absolute times or the individual times. So it is given to be Weissmann stationary with mean. Mean is 4, and the autocorrelation function is defined by this formula. Now you can see in this autocorrelation function, here it is tau. It is not T1, T2. Tau means the difference between the two times where we are taking the correlation. So autocorrelation function is defined as an argument with tau. It is given by 25 e raised to the power minus 3 modulus of tau plus 16. So that's the autocorrelation function. Mean is given to be 4. What we have to do? We have to specify, we have to find out the joint density function for three random variables. Now you can very well now see this also. how I'm defining random variable. XT is my random process. When I am taking some, when I am looking at random process at particular times as TI, I is 1, 2, and 3. So these are random variables then. And what is TI? TI is equal to T0, which is reference time, plus I minus 1 by 2. T is constant, T naught is constant. So let's try to solve this example. So my time is given by T0 plus I minus 1 by 2. T0 is constant time. So I have three actually values of I that I have to look for. I is 1, I is 2, I is 3. When you put I is equal to 1, it is T1 equal to T0, T2 equal to T0 plus half, T3 equal to T0 plus 1. After every half second, I am looking at the random process to get the random variable. Right. So we get two instances of time, Ti, because we have to define the correlation, actually. We have to actually look, once we have to, you know, find out, because the process is given to be Gaussian. And if it is Gaussian, I have to, if you remember the formula that we have just proven, there is a covariance matrix. So this is the covariance matrix. Okay, I have not drawn that. So this is the covariance matrix. Here I'm showing it is zero, but if the random variables are not independent, these will not be zero values. So since I have to look for the covariance, so that means I will look for two instances. We can pick two instances of time. One is I will define with I, the other I will define with K. All right. So what is my TI? TI is T0 plus I minus 1 by 2. What is my TK? TK is T0 plus K minus 1 by 2. And my I and K is constrained to be 1, 2, 3. And we are also given, now, you know, you can read out the question, the given question. In the question, it was said that it's a Weissmann stationary process. So that means we have to worry about Ti minus Tk. So what is Ti minus Tk? It is K minus I by 2. As it is a Weissmann stationary process, we should be interested in the time difference. So that means my autocorrelation function, which was given in the question to be 25 e to the power minus 3 tau plus 16, now I have the tau. This is Ti minus Tk is basically my tau. So my autocorrelation function, I can define to be 25 e to the power minus 3 k minus I by 2 plus 16. This is my tau basically. And I know this formula. This formula is the covariance at time Tk and Ti. This is given by the autocorrelation function minus mean square. What is my autocorrelation function? This is 25 e to the power minus 3 modulus of k minus I by 2 plus 16. This is my autocorrelation value minus 4 square, because the mean is given to be 4. So if you solve this, you will come out to be 25 e to the power, because 16 will cancel out with 16. You will be left with 25 e to the power minus 3 modulus of k minus I divided by 2. And I have k and I values as 1, 2, and 3. So by putting values of k as 1, 2, and 3, and I as 1, 2, and 3, I will get a matrix, which is my covariance matrix. So when this element is 1, 1, so that means k is 1, I is 1, so this will be 0, it will be 25. So outside the matrix will be 25, and inside the matrix, these will be the elements. So now I have the covariance matrix. I have the vector also, right? I have the autocorrelation function. And one more important thing we need to understand here is that if you know the autocorrelation function and mean, you can find out the covariance matrix. That means you can characterize the random process once you know the autocorrelation and the mean. So here is your covariance matrix. Now you can write the joint probability density function easily, no problem with that, right? So once we know the covariance and mean, we can write the joint PDF. The other question, other important one, this is also one of your question in the cheat sheet number 9. Let me show you here. Okay. If the random variables are discrete random variables, then this is my covariance matrix, right? If the random variables are discrete random variables, that's what I'm about to talk. Let the discrete time random process xn, rather than saying it is xt, now I am saying it is xn, be a sequence of independent Gaussian random variables, right? And for the case when the random variables are independent, that means I will be having only sigma square in the I will be having the covariance matrix as the diagonal matrix. And what are the diagonal elements? The diagonal elements are basically sigma square. For Ti, Tj, for various values of I and j, I will get sigma square delta ij. I can express the diagonal matrix as sigma square delta I. Now, what is this delta ij? Delta ij is the Kronecker delta function, right? What is Kronecker delta, delta function in the discrete domain? That is known as the Kronecker delta function, right? Delta ij is the Kronecker delta function, which is only one in the diagonal. That means when I is equal to j, then only this delta function is one. So that means it basically defines what? It basically defines the diagonal matrix. What are the diagonal elements? All the diagonal elements are sigma square. So if the matrix is a diagonal matrix, I can also express this as diagonal matrix. That means the sigma square, which is the, which are the values of the elements of the diagonal matrix. I can express it as the sigma square value, that means the variance value into the identity matrix, which will basically give me the diagonal matrix itself. Right. In, you know, when you have to model noise, this is, you have to prove when the noise samples are independent, and this random process can be assumed to be noise also. And most of the times, you know, when the problem is related to queuing, that 2 persons are entering, 3 persons are entering, there is a queue, then those are modeled as Poisson processes. But when it is when you're dealing with noise, you try to model it as Gaussian. So sigma square into the identity matrix will give you the diagonal matrix, which is the covariance matrix. When the Gaussian sequences are independent and identically distributed. Now let us look at the meaning of the independent and identically distributed Gaussian sequences or Gaussian random variables. Now, let's first talk about independent. All the elements will be zero in the case if it is independent, right? In case the Gaussian random sequences are independent and identically distributed, and then in the covariance matrix, all the elements will be zero except diagonal when I is not equal to j. That means we can say that the elements are uncorrelated with respect to each other. The elements are uncorrelated. That's why zero is coming at the other elements place. So when the elements are uncorrelated, that's why you are getting zero. The expected value, that means that's why you are getting there. No correlation between the two random variables. Or in the case of noise, we have to say that these are noise samples. When the noise is sampled, so you get noise samples, right? So they will be when we assume that independent, so all other elements will be zero except diagonal. But when we drop this assumption, the elements will no longer be zero. That's why we, you know, coming from the same thing, we have developed a generalized model of the joint probability density function. Now let's talk about independent, and next is identically distributed. So all the elements will have the same value, and it turns out to be sigma square. That's why I put sigma square here, rather than sigma 1, sigma 2, and so on. Identically distributed means every random variable, every Gaussian sequence, in case of discrete, every Gaussian sequence will have the same value, which is sigma square, right? So delta ij, I have already explained. What is delta ij? Is the Kronecker delta function, which is 1 in the diagonal, and it is 0 otherwise when I, that means it is 1 when I is equal to j. Otherwise, it is all 0. So what I have, this is a special case for IID Gaussian sequences. You know, when when it is not the individual product of the sigma 1, 2, 3, and sigma n, we are taking only one value. So I am taking inside the nth root 2 pi sigma square, and this is further modified. 2 I am taking inside the exponent, right? So there will not be, there will not be any matrix notation. Covariance matrix, we know that. So this is how you can have the joint probability joint probability density function in the case when the random variables are independent and identically distributed. And the other special, this is a special case. Another more generalized form is the joint probability density function when the, when we drop this condition of, when we drop this assumption of IID, right? So this is all about the Gaussian random processes. The questions are also included in your cue sheet. So if you have any specific questions, excuse me, then you can ask. Otherwise, I will add to that. Anyway, I end the lecture now, so you can ask and the questions anytime through email, through, I have repeatedly saying, through Zoom meetings and all. So thank you very much for coming.